Bob Woodward has been embroiled in controversy since he and Carl Bernstein were unearthing the Watergate scandal, but this one is different. First, in a Washington Post op-ed, Woodward showed that President Obama was wrong in insisting the White House didn't suggest the automatic budget cuts before the Republicans agreed to them. Then Woodward accused the president of changing his stance on whether the current round of budget talks should include tax increases as well as spending cuts.
You talk about the president moving the goalposts. What do you mean by that?
He was absolutely desperate to get something, so he got his benefit, and now he wants to come back and say, wait a minute, let's put some taxes in here, which he'd agreed in the sequester not to do.
The evidence on that point is mixed, but Woodward doubled down by disclosing that a top White House official had yelled at him in a lengthy phone call and then emailed that Woodward would, quote, regret taking this position. But when Politico obtained and published the actual email from economic advisor Gene Sperling, the tone was, well, less than threatening, and that became a story in itself.
I apologize for raising my voice in our conversation today.
But I do truly believe you should rethink your comment about saying that the president asking for revenues is moving the goalposts.
I know you may not believe this, but as a friend, I think you will regret staking out that claim.
So what should we make of Woodward's reporting and his tactics? Joining us now, Cenk Uygur, host of The Young Turks on Current TV and on the web. Jackie Kucinich, political reporter for USA Today, and Tim Carney, senior political columnist for the Washington Examiner. Cenk, now that we've seen the email exchange with Gene Sperling, doesn't it kind of look like Bob Woodward exaggerated this apparent pushback from the White House?
Look, I love it when anybody challenges the government, whether they're Republicans or Democrats, but he really stepped in it. He went too far here, and he got caught with his hand in, in the cookie jar. Because it's not just Gene Sperling's email where he says, as a friend, et cetera. It's Woodward's email back to him saying, oh, my friend, you never have to apologize to me.
I happen to have that here, so let's put it on the screen before I go to Tim Carney. Woodward responding to Gene Sperling, and this is the, remember, he's responding to an email that he claimed to be very upset about. You do not ever have to apologize to me, you're accurate. You get wound up because you are making your points and you believe them. This is all part of a serious discussion. I, for one, welcome a little heat. There should be more given the importance. I also welcome your personal advice. So did Woodward make a mountain out of a relative email molehill?
I think he did. I think Bob Woodward did one very good bit of reporting, which was showing that when Jack Lew and President Obama said, we didn't want the sequester, that Jack Lew and President Obama were being misleading. They may have been being dishonest. If Woodward had stopped there, it would have been great. But then going on and making it sound like he was threatened, and even the goalposts thing, I think he went too far. He should have stopped after he had done his good bit of reporting.
Now, in fairness to Bob Woodward, Jackie Kucinich, he's very careful in his language. So he didn't say he was threatened. He didn't call it an attempted intimidation. I think it was the clear implication, though. But would Bob Woodward, who's, you know, been reporting on administrations for four decades now, be intimidated by one angry phone call and an email?
Well, it sounds like he had help as well, blowing this out of proportion a little bit. I mean,
from those of us in press?
From those of us in press, there was one particular publication that reported this happened and then debunked it like 3 days later, and
what
by releasing
would that be?
It rhymes with Politico, and there was a little bit of that going on. And other publications, of course, were jumping into it as well. So I think he had a little bit of help blowing this out of proportion.
And you know, the right wing also jumped in. The right wing media did, saying, "Oh my God, look at what the Obama administration is doing." And then they backpedaled and were like, "Oh, Bob, what did you do to
us?" I did some snarky tweets making fun of the White House until the full email came out and that sort of thing. And then you realize the White House.
We've all been in the position where you're getting those emails. Every single one of us have, and it's. I mean, that's part of the job. That's part of the exchange with some of these officials and in all ranks of government.
I want to pick up your point about the conservative media, but I don't want to let this slide. A number of journalists have been saying that the Obama White House, in particular, is very aggressive in pushing back against stories that it does not like. That officials can raise their voices and perhaps use words we don't repeat on television.
Right.
You've had that experience as well.
Not myself. Yeah. I have had colleagues. Yeah, because I cover Congress. I covered the Romney campaign. I don't cover the White House. But yeah, I've heard about. But you hear that? I don't think that's unique to this administration.
Well, most people would say it's part of the game. This is a contact sport.
Right.
But a lot of people say the Obama White House, you would think, you know, because it's a Democratic White House, would get along better with journalists, but in fact can be rougher on journalists than perhaps some of its predecessors.
Well, it's an adversarial relationship, and I think everybody's doing their job if it is.
Okay, now, so let me play some more sound for you. We have Bob Woodward the other day talking about this very question. Did he mischaracterize or over-dramatize, shall we say, the email from Gene Sperling? Let's go with that first.
Do you think you might have overstepped the way you described this scenario?
No, I mean, the emails speak for themselves. It's often a technique employed by White Houses, either unintentionally or intentionally, to say, oh, let's make the conduct of the press the issue rather than what they did.
And Gene Sperling, the White House economic czar, was out on several shows this Sunday morning. First, let's take a look at what he said about this contretemps with Woodward on State of the Union earlier this morning.
Bob and I have known each other for 20 years, and we've always had a friendly and respectful relationship. Anybody who looks at the emails that went from me and that came back from him can see that there's respect and friendliness.
Does the president think that's a good idea to say to reporters if they challenge them that you're going to regret staking out that claim?
Well, David, I've had a 20-year relationship with Bob Woodward. It's been friendly. It's been cordial. Those emails are very substantive. They're cordial.
Are you threatening him in any way?
Of course not.
That, of course, David Gregory on Meet the Press. So Gene Sperling is basically saying no big deal. And in that sense, he wants to put this aside and talk about the administration's larger message. But in that sense, he's at odds with Woodward's account, correct?
Yeah. Now, there's a lot that I disagree with the administration on. But here, Gene's basically 100% right. When he told Bob Woodward, hey, you might regret this, turns out he was exactly right. Bob Woodward totally regrets it, right? I mean, at this point,
he doesn't say he regrets it.
No, but at this point, everybody's talking about how Woodward screwed up.
Instead of talking about the fact that Obama and Jack Lew were misleading when they said they didn't want the sequester, that the president and the secretary of the treasury are very comfortable revising history in a false way just to make themselves look better.
They're not talking about his reporting, they're talking about him. And I don't think any reporter really wants to be the story.
Unless you like having your name in lights.
There's that.
But which Woodward doesn't need, of course. But there is a clear ideological aspect to this in the sense that some of those who are defending Woodward are some, not all, liberal commentators who don't like who feel that Obama is being attacked unfairly. But I can't help but notice, because Woodward went on Sean Hannity's Fox News show, that people on your side of the political spectrum, many conservatives who never really had much use for Bob Woodward are now hailing him as a hero, a truth teller, because he's taken it to the White House. A little bit of ideological convenience.
Yeah, I mean, it's red jersey, blue jersey is what I describe. People get on a team and they root for whoever they think is attacking the other team, sometimes without paying very much attention to the details of the matter. And I think some conservatives are doing that now.
Yeah, and the funny thing is everybody's confused as to why Woodward is so aggressive against Obama. But he had three books that were incredibly soft on Bush. He's been hard on Obama. I'll solve the mystery for you. Woodward's a Republican. So it's not that big a
Well, he would not identify himself with either party. And you're characterizing...
No, but I'd be really surprised if Woodward wasn't voting Republican.
Okay, but you're characterizing his books as soft on Obama, but on the other hand...
Soft on Bush.
Well, you say that's soft on Bush. The last book was very critical of Bush's prosecution. But the point is, Woodward's had a lot of cooperation from this Obama White House in writing these behind-the-scenes narratives. Maybe the hidden message from Sperling is next time, not so much, buddy. And in that case, he could make you nervous.
So that's a really important point, and one that's the most important out of all of this, because it's about access. If you don't play ball, your access gets taken away. And I think that's the most dangerous thing in media. I think media has to rally right-wing, left-wing, center, and say, hey, listen, we're not going to let you get away with that anymore. We're going to report it as it is, and you're going to have to give one of us access.
And individually, every reporter has to be ready to lose access.
If you're
not going to be telling the truth, if you're constantly guarding your access to power.
I have to ask you this, because I'm sure some people watching out there today are thinking, you know, we're having $85 billion in automatic budget cuts, the so-called sequester taking effect. This is going to have an impact on people's lives, which we'll talk about in a second. And you and the media are all talking about Bob Woodward versus Gene Sperling. This must seem like incredible inside the Beltway ball to a lot of folks.
It is incredible inside. That's because it is. It really is inside the Beltway ball. There was this great Washington Post story by Paul Vahari that was about how this is like the weirdest Washington inside the Beltway navel-gazing story ever, because it really is. This is Washington.
So we think it's juicy because it involves a couple of well-known personalities in this feud, but we are, in your view, perhaps overplaying it a tad?
Absolutely.
But at the same time, the access issue is important.
I understand the access, the larger issue, and, you know, frankly, sharing private emails is a little bit, as a reporter, is a little bit unsavory.
Okay, but who actually put out the Gene Sperling email? I'm going to go out on a limb here and say it was probably the White House.
I'm saying as a reporter, when you think about those private emails that you're sending back and forth to sources, that's a little bit, but no, at the larger issue, of course, if we're talking about access, if we're talking about this, Bob Woodward v. White House, I think it's a little overblown.
Let me get to the substance here in our remaining time. I want to play for you a montage of clips of how television is covering and has been covering up until they took effect Friday midnight, the so-called sequester budget cuts.
The White House stepped up its campaign to pressure Republicans, enlisting the Secretary of Homeland Security to suggest that layoffs could make it more difficult to prevent terrorist attacks.
10,000 teachers could lose their jobs. Airport security could be cut by $323 million. 70,000 kids would be kicked off Head Start.
Means planes won't fly, trains are going to suffer, troops are going to feel the belt tightening in all branches of the service.
Sequestration isn't going to mean Armageddon for America. But the press and the political class, mostly on the left, are trying to tell you otherwise.
You're shaking, you're nodding your head, Tim Carney. A lot of the reports, particularly on television, adopting the Obama line that the sky is going to fall.
Yep, and that the sky is going to fall, that cats and dogs are going to be sleeping together, all that stuff. And, I mean, I saw NBC, I think they have an editorial policy to use the word massive when they're talking about sequestration.
Well, it's a lot of money.
It's less than 3%, I mean, of a cut. And so, yeah, I think they're way overplaying it.
I actually agree with Tim, again, on this issue. You know, I love Ed, but that, come on. Everybody's getting fired. The world's on fire. I don't believe the government. I think that they're hyping it up. I think it's politics.
I think there was room for a lot more skeptical reporting about the impact of these budget cuts. Washington Post had a great front page story the other day in which, taking the task, among other things, Education Secretary Arne Duncan, who said, quote, there are literally now teachers who are getting pink slips. A little investigation showed that was not the case. We will see what the impact is, but if the press had put in, let's say, 10% of the effort that was devoted to investigating, I don't know, Beyonce's lip syncing into the actual measurable effects of these budget cuts, I think we would have seen a somewhat different picture.